I'm Heather Dewey, the Director of Education and Volunteer Programs at the Pueblo Zoo. I'm going to talk a little bit tonight about the evolution of zoos, where we've been and where we're going forward towards conservation institutions. So America's first zoo, as they claim it to be, was in Philadelphia, opened in 1874. 600-ish animals on exhibit, and they had 250,000 visitors in the first year. The Bronx Zoo and the National Zoo in Washington, D.C. also opened about that time. And as we progress through these, kind of take a look at the slides and the pictures of the exhibit tree. So these are pretty rudimentary, elementary, basic exhibits, kind of cagey. The zookeepers look like bellhops. And they obviously get really close to the animals. Maybe some of them we wouldn't get so close to these days. So AZA is the Association of Zoos and Aquariums, founded in 1924. Today, AZA still exists, and 232 accredited institutions are a part of it, including the Pueblo Zoo, Denver Zoo, Denver Aquarium, Butterfly Pavilion, and Cheyenne Mountain Zoo are all accredited in Colorado. This comprises less than 10% of 2,800 other animal places. This is an aerial shot of the zoo when it was just opened. It had five buildings. The animal house is now Islands of Life, Tropical Bird Houses, World of Color. Monkey Island still exists, where we have our lemurs. Monkey Mountain obviously exists, but you can't access it. And the bear pits have eagles in them now that are flightless. This was the bear pits. Again, this is one of those things that we would not do anymore. Be in the bear pits with the bears in a tank top, I don't know. So we're lucky enough to have a nice little archive of photos of Pueblo Zoo things. So this is kind of where we were, right? So cages that were pretty small for the animal. Zoos kind of started out as places of exhibition where you went to go look at animals, kind of walk around. There wasn't a whole lot of education going on. That's all something that evolved over time. This would have been in the Islands of Life building. Here, where the Eco Center exists now, if you're familiar with the zoo, there were these, this bear exhibit where there were kind of pits and pools. So again, it's not a teeny weeny little exhibit, but it's not big enough, and nothing natural about it. So lots of concrete, nothing really for the bears to play with. Here we have a lion who's now outside. There's a little bit of furniture, as we call it, so some logs and things, and a hanging box for the lion to play with. Still, though, no grass and a lot of concrete in these exhibits. We believe this would have been around the Islands of Life building. So in the 70s, America became aware that it was becoming a pretty dirty place. There needed to be legislation brought forth for Clean Air Act. EPA was created. Clean Water, and we especially appreciate the Endangered Species Act. And with this came zoos realizing that the public wanted to see more empathy for animals. So an immersion exhibit design was introduced at the Woodland Park Zoo in 1978, followed closely by another gorilla exhibit at Zoo Atlanta that provided a very scenic, bigger area for animals to live and play and be in. So as compared to the bear exhibits that we had seen previously, Woodland Park Zoo in Seattle now has these large, beautiful exhibits that mirror actual life, kind of, and the space that exists in North America for bears. There's lots of water, obviously, tons of trees, and places for the animal to hide, which is really important. So zoos are becoming institutions of conservation as well as animal exhibit places. So Denver Zoo is doing work in Mongolia to help preserve habitats for Cinereus vultures. You can see a couple of Cinereus vultures at the Pueblo Zoo, Lurch and Vader. They're pretty cool animals, and Denver Zoo certainly understands that. Palm oil awareness is something that Cheyenne Mountain is taking very seriously. There's an app that you can download that I strongly recommend you do so. Rainforests in Borneo and Sumatra, where orangutans are only, are being torn down to put in palm oil, and palm oil is found in half of the products that you find in your grocery stores. So similarly, Monterey Bay Aquarium has a seafood watch app that will help you find seafood that is sustainable, that is found in restaurants and at your grocery stores, and we at the zoo will be getting to kind of push this app a little bit more and teach more about it at the exhibits. We support three conservation efforts abroad. One of them is the Painted Dog Conservation Institution in Africa, where they the monies that we send to them provide kids to go to bush camp where they learn to respect the animal instead of fear them. We also provide money to SANCOB, which is a great organization in South Africa, where they bring animals, birds back to, they rehabilitate them, whether it's been because of pollution or eating plastic from the ocean or whatever it might be. And we did have a zookeeper go there in the last year to volunteer her time, and her stories were really inspiring. And then we have the Red Panda Network, where two of our staff will be going in March and working with the network to learn more about their efforts there and volunteer and do some research and education as well for the people in Nepal. They also do things in Burma and India and China. So AZA rolled out an initiative last year called SAFE, which stands for Saving Animals from Extinction. Right now they have 10 animals that they focus on. They'd like to add more, but right now the one that we have at the zoo is the African black-footed penguin. And because of this initiative and our involvement with AZA, we are able to take advantage of some of their educational information. And the next project at the zoo is going to be a conservation garden put in that will promote pollinators, which is something that is going by the wayside in all of the country, and bee populations are down. So we're going to provide information and programming for people to understand pollinators a little bit better.
Thank you, Heather. And up next, we have Bernie Zerker.
Okay. Hi, my name is Bernie Zerker, and I'm here tonight representing an organization called EPIC that we started in Pueblo about 4 years ago. It's an acronym, stands for Executive Partnering to Invest in Children. We started this because we have some serious problems going on with our schools and our education system. At least that was our first, the first blush. That was the first thing we thought about. Truth is, in Colorado, every year, 20,000 kids drop out of high school. That's kind of shocking. Here in Pueblo, our percentage is slightly higher than the state average. In Pueblo, 29.5% of our kids don't graduate high school in 4 years. Now, being an engineer, I like to think about root causes. Henry David Thoreau said, for every 1,000 that are hacking at the branches of evil, there is one chopping at the root. So what is the root of this problem? Why do we have such an incredible dropout rate among our high school students? And it's not just here in Pueblo, it's everywhere. Well, it turns out one of the leading indicators, if we're looking for leading indicators and trying to decide where to focus our attention, we can look at third grade reading scores. Third grade reading scores are an incredible indicator of successful educational career, also success in life. So much so that in the state of California, they use third grade reading scores to decide how many prison beds they're going to need in 18 years. Kind of shocking. So why not start on third grade reading? Why don't we focus on that? Why don't we get these kids up to reading level? Well, the truth is, we're way too late if we wait to the third grade. Ellen Galinsky, in her book, Mind in the Making, talks about 7 essential life skills that are developed in a child before the age of 3. And these include things like paying attention, working well with others, grit, determination, empathy, creativity, the ability to assimilate new information and act appropriately on it. Can you see how all those things would be necessary building blocks for success in education, for success in learning and in vocabulary? Babies are born with approximately 100 billion synapses. That's almost as many as they will ever have in their entire life. By the time that baby is 1 year old, its brain doubles in size. By the time the child reaches 4 years of age, 85% of brain development has taken place. This is a period of incredible neuroplasticity. During that time, there are important connections that are made. Synapses that fire together, wire together. And those wiring connections are made for a lifetime. And these are formed at an incredible rate. Those of you who have, I'm sure all of you have children, grandchildren, nieces and nephews, but so you know that how quickly they learn and what sponges they are at these early ages. Now, through the advent of functional MRIs, we can watch as children learn, as they're being exposed to language and to pictures and to stimulation. This little baby is watching a movie. We can see in real time how that child's brain is developing and those areas of the brain that light up. That's an incredible development and has really helped researchers understand how important those early years are to language development, to vocabulary, to reading. This is a striking slide too. It shows on the left a normal 18-month-old child who was in a supportive, engaging, enriched environment. Normal 18-month-old kid. The one on the right, that is the same. It's an 18-month-old who spent the first 18 months of their life in an orphanage in Eastern Europe. So you can see the radical difference. That's why EPIC has chosen to bring a 15-minute campaign to Pueblo. This is a national campaign. It's a massive campaign, and it's absolutely essential. 1 in 3 are not ready for kindergarten, and that's a state average. It's probably a little higher than that in Pueblo. 2 out of 3 are not reading at level by the third grade. It only takes 15 minutes a day. So this 15-minute campaign, 15 minutes every child, every parent, every day. That's what it's all about. It's a massive campaign that we're taking on. It's a massive, immense challenge. We have posters that we've created, that we've published, and we're distributing all over town. We have books. We have distributed here in Southern Colorado in the last 2 years over 400,000 books. We're giving away 1,000 books a month still. We did one mass distribution 2 years ago. But on an ongoing basis, we're doing 1,000 books at DSS, Department of Social Services, the clinics, doctor's office, dentist's office, and so on. And we acknowledge that books and early childhood literacy and just reading to your child is not everything that's necessary for a healthy and enriched childhood, but there are other things. And that's, EPIC is addressing those things too. We've created what we call the Employer's Toolkit. We advocate for family-friendly work practices. We do on-the-job education for employees through what we call the Brown Bag Series. If you can imagine what it would be like here in Pueblo if every child was read to 15 minutes every day, what a change that would make in the face of education in our community, what a change it would make in our community and our society as a whole. I mean, the change is tremendous. Even grandma and grandpa have a part. Everyone who touches that child, everyone whose life is involved with that child, has an impact on that child's educational future. If we can do this together, we here in Pueblo are going to see a brighter future. And that's what we're all about, trying to make a difference in our community. Thank you.
have Fran Broden.
People heal from stress-related symptoms using my heart method of healing. The main modality that I use is a biofeedback instrument called HeartMath that helps one access their heart's intuition. These are some of the modalities that I use for the heart-based living program, and I really get a wonderful opportunity to work with people from teenagers on male, female, and they really like the program because it's a variety. It's skills, techniques, and relaxation. These are some of the symptoms that I would see in my clients that are overwhelmed, overachieving, overthinking. As they learn to tap into a new way of listening to these symptoms, they start to make shifts through the techniques and skills that I teach them. Learning to access the heart's intuitive intuition is pretty simple. It's learning how to sustain positive feelings that occur naturally during our day. For me, focusing on the day Gus and I got stuck in the rain is essential to my health and longevity. Or thinking about how beautiful my daughter was on her wedding day. Did you know that the heart forms and starts beating before the brain begins to develop? And that the heart is 60 times stronger electrically and 5,000 times stronger magnetically than the brain? Scientists recognize this and understand this electromagnetic field as our emotional brain. This emotional brain is what's supposed to be regulating our cerebral brain. Did you know that negative emotions cause nervous system chaos, and positive emotions create a synergy or a flow? And as people begin to recognize that their shallow breathing greatly impacts them, they begin to see how important it is to breathe. So these are two screenshots of the biofeedback, the heart map. The top line is the breathing, and the colors down at the bottom. Red indicates that their electromagnetic field is more in a chaotic state, where the green means they're more in that flow or that synergy. So what we do is this process where we help them to recognize that breathing combined with pulse unlocks the door, and then their emotional vibration opens the door, and then they move into this threshold of inner wisdom within the heart called heart modulation. After that takes place, this naturally occurs, where the nervous system becomes harmonized, the hormones become regulated, and it turns into what they call heart-brain coherence, which means the heart starts to activate the brain in a new way, so they become a team. Dr. Emoto's research is one of the most concrete ways for us to recognize emotions as energetic charges. Words of love and encouragement are transmitted on the left, and words of anger, criticism, are on the right. And these are just two water droplets under a microscope. So now I need to have audience participation. We're going to practice a real simple technique that I show my clients, and they're amazed at how easy they can transform as they do this process. So obviously, it's going to be real quick, and we'll just go through the next three slides. So the first one is heart focus, okay? It's mindfulness with a twist, paying attention to the present moment and noticing any sensations around the heart. At first, I didn't really notice anything, so I had to pretend. Later on, it kind of felt like a tickle or a fluffy sensation, and now it starts to feel more the expansive feeling and filling it full of love and gratitude. Step two is heart breathing, recognizing that if you focus more on your exhale, your inhale is going to happen more naturally. And I encourage people to just literally pretend that your nose is down in the heart. If there's any tension, just feel like you're breathing in and out. Did you notice any emotional reaction when you first saw that picture? And then did you notice how the mind started interrupting with unnecessary thoughts? Do your best to just try to stay being the bird, or even imagine that you are the sunset. Good job. I'm going to assume you did it. So these are the benefits to heart-based breathing. It makes drastic changes in our cognitive functioning. Symptoms become managed or fade away. Our immune system gets stronger because we're more in a restored sense. And it slows down the aging process. I'm actually 92. So our bodies are very similar to the cell phones that we have in our purses and pockets. You know, we transmit and we receive energy. Okay? And if we don't shut off those apps every once in a while, guess what? Low battery, low battery, low battery. So we have to recharge. After my clients have gone through this program and they start taking different actions, getting out of their comfort zone, we celebrate. And what that does is it helps to anchor in what they've experienced and accentuate those positive emotions so that that creative energy continues to flow. So we have a choice. Do we want to stay in that ego mind where we're in that space of chaotic fight or flight? Or do we want to step into that flow and move into a place where probably our ego mind can't even comprehend? So that's what we're focusing on. That's my picture from helping people from dealing with stress to recognizing that there's an interconnectedness, and they get to formulate that and recognize that only we can be the change that we want to see in the world. So you can view my website and those other resources for more information. It's fascinating information. And I'm giving away a free session. So I have a table out back if you want to put your name for Enter to Win. And I'm doing a heart-based meditation next Saturday. And I just appreciate your time and heart focus, heart breathing, heart feeling. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Fran. I feel much more relaxed after that. And up next, we have Chad Weber.
So how's everyone doing today? I'm here to talk to you about the newest, coolest, most hip place, new store that's just opened. My business is called Renewed Wholesale. I go to three-star and above hotels that are remodeling all over the country and bring back the furniture and sell it, you know, clean it up and sell it. But it's great furniture at a low price. So we initially started the business, and my parents have some mini storages. They're small, little square storages that just weren't going to work. You know, I get big semi-truck loads of furniture back, and so we needed something. So we got these igloos here, which are from the, they're out the Pueblo Chemical Depot. They're about 3,000 square foot each, you know, foot thick, full of concrete, big, big dome shape. And in these I can fit about two or three semi-loads. And so currently I have about four of these. But you know, it's hard to sell it because you got to ask somebody, hey, follow me 10 miles out of town. I don't know you, but let's see how this goes. So we got the building actually just right across the street, right across Main Street. I don't know if any of you have noticed any of the progress that we've been making on it, but we finally opened up. And yeah, thank you. And so this was it when we first started, and we saw it, the outside looked all right, the space was good, but we walked inside and we just saw this. And this is probably after three weeks to a month of progress. Like the right wall there, all that was covered up, it was painted. We used like this industrial paint remover to clean that whole side off. So that brick is good, but it wasn't like that. It wasn't this nice, if you can believe that. So this was now what is now the front side of the building. All the windows were covered up. You know, had those ugly lights. Floor was undone. There was tile on the floor as well. That was already done by at this point as well. But you know, I was very very nervous. Just like what are we doing here? And, you know, so this is probably after 2 or 3 months of work. It hasn't changed very much, but you know, we had the windows underneath that were just covered up, and they were all intact, amazingly. We had to replace 3 or 4 panes on the whole thing, but that was a huge plus because it has the kind of old glass that has a little bit of grain to it, and so we decided, after some deliberation, that we'd redo the whole ceiling. So we drywalled the whole ceiling, all of it. It's about 5,500 square feet of drywall. That was just awful. I can laugh about it now. So this is the back of it. And if you notice, we have the rafters painted, the top of the roof is painted. We got that ugly back drywalled, and you know, my mom painted some of the brick on the back. We got, there's 2 windows that are behind those, but they're pretty broken up and just too close to the street to really feel like we wanted to leave them open. So here we have the roof done, it's painted. We have those windows cleaned up. The brick is uncovered. There was about 1 inch of mortar, I'll just say mortar, that we had to hammer off of the whole, all that brick. We had to clean it up, you know, prime it, all that good stuff. And then this is the outside of the windows that we finally uncovered as well after we cleaned up the inside. And they have this silver film on it that took us about 3 weeks, you know, with a little razor blade to just, all of it was like that. It was the worst job I've ever done. It was like 50 hours a week of this. It was brutal. So. If you've never been to Daily Grind, Daily Grind is a great coffee place. They have good coffee. They got me through a lot of this. So we put a little bit of furniture in here and kind of got it moved in. And you know, you gotta sit down and enjoy. Sometimes you go a little crazy. So we decided to cut a new front door on the side. There was a window there, but it was pretty broken up. So you can see we're right over there on that right side. So, come say hi, but we had some people cut that open and put a new door there, and it just looks fantastic until he changes it, but we had to also change the address. So front side of the building, there was some office space, about 1,200 square feet, that was just kind of cinder blocked on the left, and it just looked awful, so we decided to change it. God just dropped some fantastic people in our laps to do the work on the right, and he had the vision for it. And so that's it after, but it was all cinder block. We got some nice windows on there. We got a business in there, Thrifty Nickel. They're an awesome advertising company. They've been family friends for a long time, so it kind of just worked out that we got them in there. And yeah, it's been great. But we finished them on September 1st, and then we still have a lot of work to do in the back. We kind of just left it alone, but we slowly started moving furniture over, and you know, we're still working. So we see the plastic in the back. We're still cleaning, painting, scraping windows, all that good stuff. I wish I would have had this about 9 months ago. You all could have came and helped us out. So this is 3 weeks ago. We don't have the back part, but we have the sandblasted floors. Get it all cleaned up. Got a little bit of everything in there. So it kind of looks like a showroom back there. You see the 2 chandeliers in the back that we got from a hotel a couple years ago, and we sat on them trying to sell them, and it just kind of worked out that they were in there. So here's my plug. So we got some pretty cool pieces. You know, I travel all over, so we go to different hotels and They're all styled a little differently. And yeah, if you haven't been there yet, come by, check it out. Even if you don't want to buy any furniture, come check out the building, because it's awesome, and I think you'll love it. And it's just nice to have some life back in there. And so this is the outside. We just finished this Saturday and Sunday. But we got all these plants in there, and trees, and lights, and it just brightens it up. So if you haven't noticed it, take a peek over there, and you'll see. And I think you really like it. It's awesome. So yeah, this is our mascot. Yeah, he's my little dog Porter. Yeah, he's 7 months old, but he loves everybody. And yeah, come by and check out the store and say hi and just enjoy the building. It's really warm, and you know, we'll get some coffee and cookies in there eventually, so you can just come and hang out. You don't have to buy anything. So thank you. Yes, go.
Wait. No, just kidding. I'm John Gallagher, and I'm the executive director at the Nature and Raptor Center. I don't normally talk this fast. I'm going to talk a little bit more about a little more personal about two things that interest me very much: bird watching and disc golf. And no, dodge birding is not a real thing. But putting the two together, that's all I can. But when you think about it, disc golf and birding do have a couple of things in common. Disc golf courses are often at really beautiful parks where there are birds, and they're both really frustrating hobbies. If you're with bird watching, you know that birds don't sit still. And if you're ever disc golfing, you know that discs don't always fly where you want them to go. Okay, so here's my origin story. We're going to kind of do a trajectory of my life through birds. This wonderful woman is my Aunt Betty. She bought me my first bird book when I was 11 years old. And the first bird that I ever identified with that bird book was a brown-headed cowbird. No, Aunt Betty is not a heavy drinker, but she does love the Buffalo Sabre. Okay, now fast forward to college. I studied ornithology in Arizona, and the Phaena pepala was a very important bird that I studied when I was in college. And later on, I worked for the Forest Service doing bird surveys, and the golden eagle was a pretty important bird for that. And that's how I met my wife, and you're going to have to ask me about that later. Being a bird watcher, people like to ask me, what is your favorite bird? And I often tell them it's the osprey. If you've never seen one, come down to the Nature Center. We have a pair that nest at the Nature Center. There's a platform there. You can see them there. The California condor is kind of an important bird to me now. At the Nature Center, we have done condor trips to the Grand Canyon area where you can see condors. And we've taken groups out there and seen condors. And we've had a condor at the Raptor Center later. And that's another story that takes more than 20 seconds that you're going to have to ask me. These two birds are important to me because I have a son named Quetzal and I have a daughter named Kawhi. Many of you out in the audience might not know that Pueblo is a real birding hotspot. We have more bird species in Pueblo than any other county in Colorado. And Colorado has a lot of bird species. Some of the hot places to go, of course, the Nature Center, you're going to want to go there. Lake Pueblo probably has more bird species than any other place in Pueblo. Mount Park and City Park are pretty good places to go, too. Okay, now together we're gonna learn some techniques in IDing birds. Birding is process of elimination. Once you know what to look for, you eliminate birds until you narrow it down to the right thing. So the first thing you want to look at is size. And you know, everybody knows hummingbird is really small. Is the bird that you've got the size of a hummingbird, or is it small like a sparrow, or is it a medium-sized bird like this robin, or is it a big bird, 22 inches like a owl here? So find a bird that you know and relate the bird that you're trying to identify that. Next, you want to look at shape. You know what? If it's shaped like a duck, it's a duck. If it's got long legs and a long neck, then that eliminates a bunch of birds. So you want to look at shape. It has a nice round head like an owl, it's fun. Bill shape is real important, not only to help you identify a bird, but also what they're eating. This cormorant up here on the left, they have a long, sharp, serrated bill for catching fish. The kinglet has a little tiny bill for catching little tiny insects. And then, of course, the kestrel is a raptor, big, sharp, curved beak for tearing into flesh. Field marks. Oh, my gosh. Crest. If you have a crest, that eliminates a ton of birds. Look for an eye line, a line going through the eye. Look for an eyebrow, a line going over the line, like in that chicken. Or maybe an eye ring. Or maybe the eye is a real interesting color like this. Rufus Saitoi has a red eye. So field marks are real important. Where you are is important. Are you at a lake? If you are, it's a good chance it could be a duck. If you're in a prairie, there's a good chance it's not a duck. But it might be the lark bunting, which is Colorado State Park. So the habitat where you're at, look at that. That'll help you eliminate some birds. Okay, now we're going to look at some birds. This is the practice one. And then the next one, it's up to you to identify. So a cedar waxwing, beautiful bird, has kind of a black mask that's more than an eye line. It has a crest. It's kind of laid back, but it's there. Look at the yellow on the tail. Okay, now you get to join me in the tyranny of 20 seconds. Look at this bird. You've got 20 seconds. Well, now you got 15. Look as much as you can. Notice the field marks. Notice the colors, different things. And then after 20 seconds, you're going to tell me what you saw. Okay.
Not a duck.
It's not a duck. You're going to have to just yell it out. You saw an eye line. What color? It's important. Black eye line. What else? Okay. Good. Now, you pull out your bird book, and you got to pick it out of all the birds there. Okay, there it is. Okay, so it's a sparrow, obviously.
White-crowned.
Does anybody see it? Some people are saying white-crowned sparrow. I think that's consensus. Two people said white-crowned sparrow. Let's see. You didn't need the 20 seconds. There it is. Yes, white-crowned sparrow. Oh, gambles form. Nobody said that. So you go to your bird book, you go to the internet, and there's so much you can learn about a bird from that. There's the range map. The blue is where it lives in the winter. You'll see it's here in the winter. I heard one at the Nature Center today, so they're already here. You can learn all this other information, the habitat and all that stuff. I happen to lead bird walks at the Nature Center on the fourth Saturday, so I encourage you to come down and check that out. If not, maybe I'll see you at City Park doing some disc golf. Or maybe I'll see you there doing some birding, because it's great for both. But I wouldn't recommend doing both at the same time. Thank you.
Thank you, John. And next, we have Christina Anderson.
I'm going to talk to you about my passion. My passion is the performing arts, and I'm going to tell you about my 30 years of experience in the performing arts and many wonderful organizations that I've worked with here in Pueblo. So, what are performing arts? Singing, dancing, acting, those are the main ones, right? You play an instrument, an instrumentalist, those kind of things are the performing arts. And actually, this month is National Arts and Humanities Month, so what a great topic for my Pecha Kucha, right? So, once upon a time, where did I start? Well, up here, I thought I was a rock star, obviously, in a recording studio, probably working on some kind of Whitney Houston song, probably belting out, you know, I want to dance with somebody or something, because that's what I did back in the day, right? But the gentleman in the middle of that picture, Ken Butcher, who I feel is the godfather of music in this town, was my music teacher at Centennial High School and sparked my love of music. So I graduated from high school. Flight attendant or marriage? That was pretty much my choice. I was not going to work in the performing arts. I was going to be a flight attendant and fly the friendly skies. That was my job I was going to go for. Well, my husband proposed marriage and changed my plans completely. So what did I do? I went back to my first love of performing. I started working for a company out of Denver, Eastern Onion Singing Telegrams, and I sang to the first passengers getting off at DIA. Right there, to dream the impossible dream. DIA, we've been waiting so long. So there I am, yes. So I did all kinds of singing telegrams. Went to Fort Carson a lot pregnant to tell a lot of guys they were going to be dads. So, and then what did I get into doing? I got into doing teaching music, of course, you know. They ask you to do all kinds of things when you don't have a degree in music. And so I started teaching at two different Christian schools, taught there for 5 years, and now I'm back at St. John Newman teaching music there this year. So where did I learn my skills? I joined the Pueblo Choral Society. What a great organization this is in Pueblo. If you don't go see one of their concerts, you should. But that is where I learned my leadership skills. They threw me on the board at 20 years old. Who does that? And they said, go for it. Do our public relations. And then in the Pueblo Choral Society, I met some wonderful ladies, Barbara Beck being one of them, who just recently passed away of breast cancer. Christine Reed and I started the Pueblo Children's Chorale in 1996. Woo-hoo! Yes. So the Children's Chorale, we are in our 21st year. We have a concert next week, by the way, for All Pueblo Reads. And we do that every year as part of the All Pueblo Reads. We have done some awesome things. We provide unique performance opportunities for our kids. We have been to Washington, D.C. We've been to Disneyland twice. And we even brought Miss America in 2004 out to sing with the kids. That's them performing at Disneyland, too. We have won some awesome awards. Thank you, Pueblo, for voting for us for Best of Pueblo. We have won gold several times for Best After School Program. We just won silver last week. So we're rocking. We're going on with all the accolades. It's awesome. And our kids rock. So you should come to their concert next week. Just saying. So what do I do after I started the Children's Chorale? Well, there's all these kids that are growing up, and they're in high school, they're in college, they love to perform. So what do? I provide another opportunity for them to perform. I started Upon a Star singing telegrams and entertainers. Went back to singing telegrams, go figure. It's a lot of fun. And we started with caroling. Caroling was the first request in Pueblo. So they wanted carolers in the downtown area. So if you see my carolers around, that's us. But what else do we do? You do what? A lot of people ask me, you do all this crazy stuff? Yes, we do princess parties. We do superhero parties. I dress as a pirate and go sing, you know, to guys that just got out of the hospital. We sing at the Rosemont Museum. We do all kinds of stuff. Custom entertainment, we love to do it. So if you need, you know, 50s and 60s music for an anniversary party, we got you. So we have also won some awesome awards over the years. Upon a Star Entertainers has won Best Birthday Parties for Best of Pueblo a few years in a row, and I just won a three-peat as best performer in Pueblo, so gold winner. So thank you, that's awesome. And we've been to Disneyland twice too with that group, so I've taken count of four groups to Disneyland to perform. Yes. So what do? After you learn how to sing, well, you go into acting, right? Why not? Because what else is there? So this group, Musical Community Productions, I love them. I have several cast members here tonight. They're awesome. And then what do? I start dancing. I can't dance to save my life, but they wanted me in the Nutcracker as Mrs. Stahlbaum, so guess what? I was Mrs. Stahlbaum last year. I'll be Mrs. Stahlbaum this year. You'll see me. And there I am as Mother Ginger. Total transformation of my life, being Mother Ginger. That was a highlight. And then, of course, the Romeo and Juliet. And so then what do? Jeannie's here tonight. Jeannie with Jeannie's Academy of Dance. I got involved with her too. She's awesome. And yes, you can dance as an adult. You can totally get out there and rock it, no matter what. And I mean, no matter what size you are, no matter how old you are, just get out and dance. It's just fun. That's all I'm going to say about it. And look it, I'm having a great time. So pageantry. Now I'm going to jump huge. I got involved in pageantry way back in 19... I'm not going to tell you when. I'm doing the Miss Teen Pueblo pageant. And then in 1993, I did Mrs. Colorado, and there is not enough butt glue in the world to make me go back and do Mrs. Colorado again. I'm just going to say that. You see things backstage you just can't unsee. I'm just going to say it. But then I won Miss Colorado 2015 last year, so I was your Miss Colorado for the Miss Pueblo pageant for a whole year, and I was the talent winner as well. So, woohoo! Yeah, I had a great year as Miss Colorado. no butt glue involved in this pageant. Total natural. No duct tape, nothing, okay? So how was my year as Miss Colorado? Well, as you can see, I was busy. I made 50 appearances over the year. It was a total blast. I read to kids. Where's the reader? See, I'm reading to kids right there. And I would totally do it again. So if you want me to read to kids, I'm your gal, okay? So I just want to thank my husband, Mark, because I've been married for 25 years. Yes, I got married at the age of 10. I look fantastic. And my husband is my life. And if it wasn't for him talking me into marriage instead of being a flight attendant, I would never be doing what I am today. So I am so thankful for that, honey. Thank you. I love you. And where does my inspiration come from? It comes from Disney, man. That's all I'm going to say. I am the biggest Disney fan in the world, and my whole Pecha Kucha could have been about Disney if I wanted it to, but I didn't want to, like, totally bore you with all my craziness. But all our dreams can come true if you have the courage to pursue them. That is my mantra. That is what I live by. I take it to heart every single day. Thank you, Pueblo.
Christina, and up next we have Victor Reyes and Glenn Ballantyne.
Yeah, I don't think I could fit in Christina's life.
Wow. The most well-known natural disaster in Pueblo's history is the Great Flood of 1921. But one of the most notable things about that flood was not the horrendous amount of damage or lives lost, but that Pueblo demonstrated it's a community with heart. The flood was caused by a sudden downburst of the Arkansas River 10 miles west of Pueblo. The flood became worse when the Fountain Creek began to flood 30 miles north. When those two merged in Pueblo, the result was catastrophic. 1,500 people lost their lives, and almost all of the buildings and businesses on Union Avenue in the downtown area were destroyed. That horrible night in June, the telephone operators worked through the night on the third floor, even when the floodwaters reached nearly 10 feet above the street. Telephone operators were working, they were isolated. There was no way that people could get to them or help them, nor for them to leave. And instead of panicking, they stayed, they worked, and they did an outreach of helping people that they didn't even know. That horrible night in June, the telephone operators worked. They received and relayed countless phone calls and distress calls from families who were trapped in the floodwaters. The operators were eventually rescued and helped save thousands of lives. They were taken to the Elks Club, where they were served in the relief center for 3,000 newly homeless Puebloans. But with an undefeatable sense of community, compassion, and vision, within 3 years, neighborhoods and businesses were operating smoothly, and Pueblo was once again a productive and a very desirable city to live in.
But like any other community, Pueblo today does have its challenges, be it enough shelter for people to live in, resources to address addictions, lack of centers to help, domestic violence issues, and giving youth healthier options and alternatives. But like in 1921, Pueblo is once again demonstrating its resolve and determination to overcome these and other issues. To make meaningful and sustainable change, it is imperative that we remain centered and balanced no matter what the intensity of emotions that are fueled by feelings of frustration, anger, and doubt are hitting us with. A belief that things can always get better allows for proactive type of humane solutions that come from a place of clarity, reason, and positive energy. Just like in 1921, empathy alone will not be enough. Compassion, empathy for another's suffering accompanied by an action to alleviate that suffering, is an antidote to the poisons that are weakening our community today. In order to be in a position that is of the most benefit to others, it is up to us individually, to develop within ourselves a heart so immersed in loving kindness that compassion flows naturally. To begin the process of opening the heart through loving kindness, Alan Wallace, a preeminent scholar and teacher, has suggested four questions that we should ask ourselves. Through such self-awareness, we, in this room, can begin the process of developing an even more compassionate and conscious community. As these questions are asked, we're asking you just to take a second and reflect on what your answer would be.
So the first question is to ask yourself, what would make me truly happy? What is my heart's desire?
Next, what would I love to receive from the world that would help me become the person I realistically want to be? What type of support would I want from those around me?
What is it about me that I would like to change? What qualities and virtues would I need to increase in order to grow as a human being?
The last question. I'm an integral part of Pueblo's present and future. What can I see as my role in transforming our community into being an even more compassionate and conscious one? What can I do?
The power for change comes from moving empathy into action. The green of a forest is the result of the health of each of the individual trees. The level of compassion and consciousness in Pueblo is dependent upon the level of openness in each of our hearts. Pueblo's 1921 disaster came about through the power of nature. However, what Pueblo faces today is a result of the power of the human condition. It is only through the lens of the higher consciousness and by developing a more compassionate heart that we can best serve others who are desperately lost and in need. Can we find inspiration and see new possibilities by looking at ways other communities have improved their human condition? Common measurements promoted by politicians include the sheer number of police officers, arrests, and convictions, and by banishing the homeless.
The phrase gross national happiness is a measurement of collective happiness of a community. The term was coined in 1972 and represented a commitment by some nations and some cities to building economies that would be based on quality of life values instead of using employment income and sales tax numbers. In order to support your community, you must have a solid foundation. The four foundations of this philosophy are as follows. One, sustainable development that isn't a roller coaster of bust and boom. Preservation and promotion of virtues and ethics. Conservation of the natural environment and establishment of honest, fair, and quality leadership. So the question then becomes, why don't we develop our own happiness index grounded on having our basic needs met for food and shelter, safety, friends and family, work, healthy environments and service? This way, Pueblo could become the most well-known human miracle that flows from compassion and consciousness making Pueblo the happiest place on earth.